الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا محمد حبيب رب العالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه الطاهرات أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق، ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم، وعلى آله وصحبه حق قدره ومقداره العظيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. فاللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا ووفقنا للعمل فيما يرضيك عنا، بجاه نبيك الأكرم صلى الله عليه وسلم وبسر الفاتحة. بسم الله Thereafter, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who has allowed us and invited us to his house, for no one knocks the door of anyone except with an invitation and except with permission. And Allah azza wa jal has allowed us to come and sit in his house, and we have to remember that we have not been allowed to enter into his house except with his permission and except with an invitation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have hopes in the generous Jalla Jalaluhu that now that he has allowed us to come into his house, that he will flow with his generosity upon each and every one of us. And we ask that generous Lord of ours to send his peace, blessings and rest upon our master Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his blessed household, his loyal companions, his blessed wives, our mothers, and all of those who followed after them with excellence up until the day of standing. Ameen, ameen, ameen. Thereafter, we will continue, inshallah, in the khutbah of the great Imam Abu Zakariya Yahya Sharafuddin al-Nawawi radiyallahu anhu in his work Riyad al-Salihin min kalam Sayyid al-Mursaleen sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka sallam. So the point that we had reached was when the Imam radiyallahu anhu said, أَمَّا بَعْدُ فَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ. We had reached a few lines after this verse, but to start with the verse in taking blessings from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Shaykh radiyallahu anhu cited a verse from Surah Al-Thaliyat in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that I did not create jinn or mankind except to worship me, except to worship me. One of the great scholars of tafsir, one of the great scholars who explained the noble Qur'an al-Kareem, and he was from amongst the awliya, the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibn Ajiba, Imam Ibn Ajiba radiyallahu anhu. When he speaks about this verse, he says something beautiful. He said that kings and princes and people of such high ranks, when they have servants and slaves, what is the purpose of those servants and slaves? What's the purpose of those servants and slaves? He says the purpose of servants and slaves is to serve the king, right? To bring food to the king, to bring drink to the king, to bring comfort to the king. He said, Imam Abu Ajib radiallahu anhu said, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is Malik al-Muluk, he is the king of kings. But he did not worship, he did not create any of us to serve him in that way. He did not create any of us to serve him in that way. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free of eating, free of drinking, he is free of being served by anyone, and he is free of being in need of anyone's service. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free of being in need of anyone's service. Each and every one of us, every human being, is in need of the service of his brother or sister, right? Our parents, they take honor in bringing up their children, and they serve their children. And children serve their parents, and brothers and sisters amongst each other, they serve each other. And this is how life on this planet continues. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is he in need of us presenting food to him? No, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't eat. Is he in need of us presenting drink to him? No. No, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't drink. So what type of servants are we to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What type of servants are we? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I did not create jinn and mankind except that they worship him. We are servants who are in need of our master Jalla Jalaluhu, and he is not in need of us. We're the ones who are in need of him. That he provide for us, not that we bring him food, because he is transcendent and glorified beyond food, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ibn Ajib radiallahu anhu, he said, now this meaning that I have mentioned, this can be seen clearly in the next verse. He said, Allah said in the next verse, مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ بِالْرِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَن يُطَعِمُونَ Allah said, I do not want from mankind and jinn that they provide rizq, they provide sustenance and provision. And nor do I ask them to come and feed me. أَن يُطَعِمُونَ Nor do I ask them that they feed. Right now here, the scholars have said, either this is feeding in general, or this is feeding feeding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said, مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ I don't ask them to provide rizq, to provide food and drink and provision. Why? Because Allah is not in need of it, number one. وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَن يُطْعِمُونَ And not that, do I ask them to feed. Feed whom? The scholars have said, here we have two interpretations. One is that feed one another, feed fellow human beings, or feed fellow jinn. And the other is that Allah doesn't ask us, as he is the king, and the king of kings, he doesn't ask us to feed him. Like other kings ask their servants and slaves to come and feed them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like them. Is that clear? So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having us as servants, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having us as servants, is this to serve his needs? No, because Allah has no needs. Is that clear? But rather, he has us as servants and slaves so that we can benefit from that slaveship. We can benefit from that servanthood. And the greatest honor, and the greatest honor and the highest rank that a human being can ever reach is the rank known as the rank of Ubudiyyah. The rank of Ubudiyyah. And that is the rank of absolute slaveship, absolute servanthood, an absolute servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you look into the Quran al-Kareem, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about a great miracle or a great event in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was described with the station of ubudiyyah, of absolute slavehood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, absolute servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, two of the greatest miracles that the Prophet ﷺ was given, one was the Qur'an. And when Allah speaks about the Qur'an and its revelation in the Qur'an, Allah said in Surah Al-Kahf, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala amdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. Allah said in Surah Al-Kahf, praise be to the one who revealed the book to his special servant. He didn't say to his Prophet, to his messenger, but rather to his special servant. And who is that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was one of the greatest miracles. Another one of the greatest miracles was when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taken on the night journey and through the heavens, where he saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how did Allah describe that in the Quran? Allah said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi. Allah said, glory be to the one who took his special servant in the night journey, right? So the Prophet ﷺ, in both relation to the Quran and in relation to the traveling of the night, is described with what station? The station of ubudiyyah, absolute servitude and slaveship. And this is an absolute core concept in our religion. This is an absolute core concept in our religion that we must understand, realize, and be able to apply within our lives throughout our lives. This is a station that no Muslim and no human being should be away from. The station of slaveship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll give you an example. In the Quran al-Kareem, We are often instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do certain things, but we scratch our heads and we think, but why? Isn't that right? For example, Allah says, pray 2 fard for Fajr, but for Dhuhr, pray 4 fard. The Prophet explained this in the Sunnah, that 2 fard for Fajr and 4 for Dhuhr. 4 for Asr, 3 for Maghrib, and 4 for Isha. This is the fara'id. You see, why? Why the changing number? Allah said, make tawaf around the Kaaba how many times? 7 times. You think, why 7? Why not 8? Why not 14? Why this particular number of 7? Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, keep away from this type of haram and that type of haram. Keep away from this act and keep away from that act. Sometimes you can understand why Allah has instructed us to keep away from certain things. But at other times, our minds cannot comprehend and understand why did Allah instruct us to do this and why did Allah prohibit us from this. The scholars of Islam have said, there is nothing which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs or He prohibits, except within that instruction and prohibition, there is the highest levels of wisdom. Why? Because Allah said in the Quran, حِكْمَةٌ بَالِغَةٌ. Allah said, the utmost high levels of wisdom. حِكْمَةٌ بَالِغَةٌ. The highest levels of wisdom. Now, that level of wisdom, we might not be able to grasp and comprehend that level of wisdom. Then your question is going to be, but why? That's when our ubudiyyah comes into action. And what's ubudiyyah? Total slaveship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, let's take an example of the dunya. If a person had a slave, let's say a king, or a rich person, or a prince had a slave, the king instructs the slave and says, do this. Does the slave have a right to say why? No. He's a slave. He doesn't own anything. He belongs to his master. Likewise, we are all slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are all servants to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't have a right to say why. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His generosity, explains to us why, then that's His generous nature, Jalla Jalalu. But at times He won't explain to us why, to test us whether we will still be servants or we will rebel and say why. Is that clear? So this is what Imam Ibn Ajiba radiallahu anhu explains about this verse, that about وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Then Imam Nawawi radiallahu anhu continues and he says, وَهَذَا تَصْرِيحٌ بِأَنَّهُمْ خُلِقُوا لِلْعِبَادَةِ. He said this verse is a clear-cut evidence and text and statement from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we were not created for any other purpose except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the great Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Shatibi radiallahu anhu, one of his du'as was, oh Allah, occupy me for that which you have created me for, and do not occupy me in that which you have created for me. Did you get that? He used to make a du'a, oh Allah, occupy me for the reason that you created me. And what's the reason that Allah created us? Worship, ibadah. And don't occupy me in that which you created for me. And what did Allah create for us? Allah said, وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah said, and we have prepared for you what is in the heavens and the earth, all for mankind, all for the human being. Right? So the Imam is making a dua. Oh Allah, don't make me occupied in the things that are serving me, but rather occupy me for the reason that you created me for. And what's that? Service to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything in the world serves mankind. Everything in the world serves mankind. And mankind is supposed to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not get occupied in that which is serving Him. Is that clear? So Imam Nawawi radiallahu anhu said, وَهَذَا تَصْرِيحٌ. And this is clear-cut evidence and a statement from Allah, بِأَنَّهُمْ خُلِقُوا لِلْعِبَادَةِ, that we were created for worship. فَحَقَّ عَلَيْهِمُ الْإِعْتِنَاءُ بِمَا خُلِقُوا لَهُ. Then Imam Nawawi said, and it is a duty upon each and every one of them that they concern themselves with that they were created for. And what's that? Worship and ibadah. وَالْإِعْرَاضُ عَنْ حُذُوذِ الدُّنْيَا بِالزَّهَادَةِ And that they push away from the dunya. They push away from the worldly matters by zuhd, by abstinence, by giving up matters of the world. The Imam رضي الله عنه said, وَالْإِعْرَاضُ عَنْ حُذُوذِ الدُّنْيَا بِالزَّهَادَةِ To warden off and push away and turn away from the matters of the dunya by abstinence. Why? فَإِنَّهَا دَارُ نَفَادٍ Because this world, this abode, this home that we live in, right, will end. لَا مَحَلُّ إِخْلَادٍ And it's not the abode which will last forever. وَمَرْكَبُ قُبُورٍ لَا مَنْزِلُ حُبُورٍ And it is a vehicle that we travel on, and it's not a house or an abode or a place that we stop and be joyful and happy. It's not the abode of happiness. It's the abode of traveling. This whole world is like a vehicle that we are traveling on to get to the Akhirah, which is our home. So our watan al-asli, our homeland is the gardens of paradise, inshallah. Right? So how do we get home? We catch the bus, we catch the train, we catch the plane, right? And what's the bus, the train, and the plane? This world that we're living on. Is that clear? Now tell me, someone who jumps onto the bus, gives the bus driver 50 pence, and stays on the bus all day until the end of the day, and the bus driver jumps out, and the passenger says to the bus driver, I'm sleeping here tonight. What is he going to think of it? He says he nuts, lost his brains. Is that clear? Likewise, this is how the dunya is. The dunya is a vehicle. The people who attach themselves heavily to the dunya and don't want to move to their watan al-nasri, and they don't yearn towards the gardens of paradise, they don't have a shawq, they don't have something that pulls them back home to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the gardens and luxuries of paradise. They've lost their brains. Right? They've lost their brains. Because they're like the person who wants to sleep on the bus. وَمَشْرَعُ إِنْفِصَامٍ لَا مَوْطِنُ دَوَامٍ And he said this world is a street that will come to an end. It's a road that you walk on and then it will come to an end. And not مَوْطِنُ دَوَامٍ And it's not a place of continuity. فَلِهَذَا And for this reason, كَانَ الْأَيْقَاظُ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا هُمُ الْعُبَّادِ He said, for this reason, for the reason that I have mentioned, the most awakened of human beings, the most awakened of human beings are the people of worship, the عُبَّاد, the people of عِبَاد. Why are they the most awakened of people? Why are they the people whose hearts are the most awake? Because they realize the reality of this world. And what's the reality of this world? It'll come to an end. Why on earth bother with it so much if it's going to an end, come to an end? Why not bother with that which will never come to an end? Worship here so that it will become light for us on the day of judgment and our worship will take us into the gardens of paradise. It will take us into the gardens of paradise. But people who just accumulate the dunya, right? And fill themselves with so much of worldly affairs and do not concern themselves with the affairs of the Akhirah. When they die and reach their graves, their hands will be empty of pounds and gold and silver, but also their books of deeds will be empty of good deeds. And if someone's books of deeds are empty of good deeds, then there will be no light for them in their grave. There will be nothing that will take them and push them towards the gardens of paradise. So Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, he said the most intelligent and the most awakened people in this world are the ubbad, the people of ibadah, the people who strive in worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know, in our times, someone who can pray their five daily prayers is someone who is striving in their ibadah. Someone who prays fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib and Isha is someone who is striving. Why? Because we're living at the end of times. And the Prophet said, worship at the end of times and clinging on to one's religion at the end of time is like holding heated coal. Imagine the gas fires at home. You bring your hand close to them and you feel heat and you retract. Imagine holding a heated piece of coal. That's how difficult it is to practice this religion towards the end of times. So the most intelligent of people are the Rabbah, the worshippers. وَأَعْقَلُ النَّاسِ فِيهَا هُوَ الزُّهَادِ. He said, the most awakened of people are the people of worship, and the most intelligent of people are the Zuhad. And who are the Zuhad? The people who are abstinent from the dunya. They are abstinent from the dunya. They live with enough and they move along. They live with enough and they move along. They don't accumulate that which is more than they need. They don't accumulate that which is more than they need. Why? Because if they accumulate that which is more than they need, then their desires grow. How do a person's desires grow? When you see more of the dunya. When you see less of the dunya and you don't know about the luxuries of the dunya, then you won't have a desire to put something. Is that clear? And then Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu cites another verse from the Quran al-Kareem, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا مَثَلُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ مِمَّا يَأْكُلُ النَّاسُ وَالْأَنْعَامُ حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذَتِ الْأَرْضُ زُخْرُفَهَا وَزَيَّنَتْ وَظَنَّ أَهْلُهَا أَنَّهُمْ قَادِرُونَ عَلَيْهَا أَتَاهَا أَمْرُنَا لَيْلًا أَوْ نَهَارًا فَجَعَلْنَاهَا حَصِيدًا كَأَنْ لَمْ تَغْنَ بِالْأَمْسِ كَذَلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Now this verse is a very moving verse. We have to listen to this very carefully. And this verse will describe to us the state of the world and the state of human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. The example of this worldly life, كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ, is like water that we send from the skies, i.e. like rainwater. فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ. When rainwater comes down, it mixes with the vegetation of the earth. Vegetation that is eaten by human beings and by animals. Allah said, the example of this world, the example of this worldly life is like rainwater which comes from the skies, mixes with the earth in which there is vegetation. That vegetation is eaten by human beings and animals. So there's a subtle meaning just there. What's the subtle meaning that Allah is trying to indicate? Allah is indicating towards all of us that you, human beings and animals, in eating are the same. In eating and needing to fill your stomachs are the same. Of course, mankind will have greater etiquette in eating, greater adab in eating, but nevertheless, in having food in the stomach, there is no difference between us and the animals. If we don't have food in the stomach, if we don't use this sabab, what's going to happen? We'll become ill, we'll become poorly, and it might cause our death. Likewise, animals. Animals, if they don't eat, they cannot survive. Is that clear? So that's the first subtle meaning that's here. Then Allah said, so after sending the rain from the skies, which mixes with the vegetation of the earth, which is eaten by mankind and animals, حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذَتِ الْأَرْضُ زُخْرُفَهَا. Once this rain comes from the heavens, mixes with the vegetation of the earth, what happens? You see beautiful crops. You see what? Beautiful crops. You see plants. You see vegetables. You see wheat. You see barley. You see rice. Right? All of these crops, what is it that allows them to grow? Rainwater. Yeah? But crops and vegetables are not our only food. We also eat meat, right? But how do those animals survive? By eating those crops, by eating grass, by eating vegetation. So those animals, they go and eat the vegetation of the earth, and then we are able to eat the meat of the animals. Is that clear? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, by us sending rain from the skies, human beings can live, eat vegetables and vegetation and fruit and animals can live and become a source of food for mankind. Right? Now, once we eat, what happens? Our bodies become nourished. We have strength. Our bodies become nourished. We have strength. When we have healthy animals, we can have more meat. When you have good crop, we can have more vegetables. We can have wheat, barley, rice, all types of vegetables and all types of fruits. Now, what's the picture that we have in our head? The picture that we have in our minds is of a beautiful green world where there's vegetables, where there's animals, where there's human beings. And everyone's healthily growing. Right? Everyone's healthily growing. What does Allah say next? حَتَّى إِذَا أَخَذَتِ الْأَرْضُ زُخْرُفَهَا. Allah said, we send this rainwater from the heavens up until the point that the earth takes its decoration. The earth is able to decorate itself. How does the earth decorate itself? By the greenery, by the animals, by the fruits, by the crop. Is that clear? So once the rainwater falls and everything becomes good and healthy, and the earth is decorated by this rainwater dropping, وَظَنَّ أَهْلُهَا أَنَّهُمْ قَادِرُونَ عَلَيْهَا. This is probably one of the most important points of this verse. You know, when human beings, they see rainwater come from the sky, crops grow, animals eat those crops or eat grass, and the animals grow, now human beings can eat meat and eat vegetables. So, what happens in the human mind? We think, we are our own providers. Rain comes from the sky, we plant the crops, we harvest the crops, we eat the crops, we have animals, we provide food for them, we send them out, they eat the grass, they grow, we take milk from them, we take meat from them, and everything's lovey-dovey. We've got control over the planet. We've got what? Control over the planet. This is exactly what Allah says. وَظَنَّ أَهْلُهَا. The inhabitants of the earth begin to think أَنَّهُمْ قَادِرُونَ عَلَيْهَا. That they are empowered in this earth. They are empowered in this earth, and they have dominance on this earth, and they have control of this earth. They have control of this earth. Allah says, when man feels that he has control of this earth, then what do we do? Initially we sent him rain, and we sent him rizq, and we sent him means by which he can live. But those means by which he can live took him to a transgression, took him to a transgression that he thought he has power over the earth, and he is the all-powerful, and he has control over everything. Allah said, when man thinks that he has control over everything, أَتَاهَا أَمْنُنَا لَيْلًا أَوْ نَهَارًا فَجَعَلْنَاهَا حَصِيدًا كَأَنْ لَمْ تَغْنَ بِالْأَمْسِ. Allah says, when man feels that he has control over the earth, that's when we send our punishment to him, لَيْلًا أَوْ نَهَارًا, during the night or during the day. Such a punishment, فَجَعَلْنَاهَا حَصِيدًا. Allah said, a punishment that wipes them out and makes them like harvest. Wipes them out and makes them like harvest. كَأَنْ لَمْ تَغْنَ بِالْأَمْسِ. As if they did not exist yesterday. You know, when the crops are harvested, when the crops are cut, right, and taken, people take them into their homes. If you come into that field, you won't be able to recognize whether there was crop here yesterday or not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says exactly that about human beings who feel that they have power and control over the earth. Allah said, He leaves them. And as this feeling and notion within them grows and grows and grows, Allah says, that's when we send our punishment to them. And we destroy them such, we get rid of them such, كَأَنْ لَمْ تَغْنَ بِالْأَمْسِ, as if they did not exist yesterday. Allah said, كَذَٰلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ. Like that we explain our verses. How did Allah explain the verse? If you look at the verse right from the beginning, drops of water, how much impact they had. The crops grew, animals ate grass, animals grew, human beings grew, and then man thought he has control over the earth. Allah said, كَذَٰلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ. Like this, we explain our signs. For who? لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. For a people who contemplate, for a people who think, for a people who use their intellect. Is that clear? And then Imam al-Nawawi رضي الله عنه said, والآيات في هذا المعنى كثيرة. And such like verses in the Quran are plenty. Verses which indicate to us that this world in comparison to the hereafter is nothing. Verses that indicate to us that this world that human beings are chasing is but mata'ul ghurur. It's but a deception. It deceives mankind. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا حُرَّةٌ خَضِرَةٌ. Showing the world is green and sweet. It's green and sweet. And something that's green and something that's sweet, what does it do to the eye? It attracts. Right? So the dunya is green and sweet such that it attracts human beings to it. Right? But those who get attracted to it, they become the losers. Then Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu said, وَلَقَدْ أَحْسَنَ الْقَائِلِ. He said, the sayer had said something very beautiful. And the sayer is Imam Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. Imam Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, he was a great poet of Islam also. But he did not indulge in poetry too much. He used to say, if I said poetry, I could say poetry like the pre-Islamic poets. But I don't want to say poetry. This is why his poetry is very little. Why is this? Because the scholars said it does not befit scholars to go into poetry. Why? Because scholars of Islam are the inheritors of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran and he said, وَمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ الشِّعْرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ. We did not teach him poetry and nor does it befit him. We did not teach him poetry and nor does it befit him. And what type of poetry is this speaking about? This is with regards to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's speaking about all types of poetry. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the Quran al-Kareem, which was much beyond poetry. Right? And in terms of other Muslims, normal Muslims or scholars from amongst the Muslims, it's speaking about foul poetry. Poetry which is indecent. Is that clear? As for poetry which praises the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet would sit and listen to Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu. He would listen to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Rawaha and other companions praise him in poetry. Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ عِبَادًا فُطَنَا طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا وَخَافُ الْفِتَنَا. He said, surely Allah has ibadah. He has certain servants and slaves. Futana. They are extremely intelligent. They are what? Extremely intelligent. طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا وَخَافُ الْفِتَنَا. They divorced the dunya. They divorced the world and they fear tribulations, trials and tests. So what does the Imam say? طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا. They divorced the dunya. I.e. they detached themselves from indulging themselves in what Imam uses, that they divorce. And when does divorce occur? When there is a marriage. Right? In a marriage relationship, the married couple have the closest relationship that can ever be found on the planet. Right? The closest relationship that any human beings can have is the relationship of marriage. Is that clear? Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, he said, and when that relationship of marriage breaks up, what occurs? It's talaq. And when that talaq occurs, both of the spouses, they detach each other from each other. And that's it, normal relations. Imam al-Shafi'i said, Allah has certain awliya and certain friends and certain servants who are like this. طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا. They divorced the dunya. Is that clear? They divorced the dunya. Number one, وَخَافُ الْفِتَنَا. And they fear tribulations, trials and tests. And we should be fearing them in our times more than any other time. For the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that towards the end of time, tribulations and trials and tests will be like قِطَعٍ لَيْلٍ مُظْلِمًا, will be like tribulations and tests will fall upon people like dark pieces of the night. You know when it's pitch black and the night is absolutely dark, right? Imagine a portion of the dark night being thrown upon a person. This is how fitan will be thrown upon people. And the Prophet ﷺ said, يُصْبِحُ الرَّجُلُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا وَيُمْسِي مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا. The Prophet ﷺ said that tribulations and trials and tests will come upon people such that a person will be Muslim in the morning and he will sleep at night as a kafir. He'll give up his religion. And another person will sleep at night as a Muslim and wake up as a kafir. Why? The Prophet explains, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بِعَرَضٍ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا قَلِيلٍ. People will sell their religion cheap. People will sell their religion cheap. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about his religion and he said, أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةٌ. He said, no, the merchandise of Allah is expensive. It's expensive, it's not cheap. So Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ عِبَادًا فُقَلَى. Allah has these intelligent servants. طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا. They divorce the dunya. وَخَافُ الْفِتَنَا. And they fear tribulations, trials and tests in their religion, not in their dunya. If their wealth expires one day, they won't be worried. They'll still be steadfast because Allah is the provider, right? If their houses are robbed, they'll be concerned, but that won't put them back in their religion. Is that clear? Because they know that the provider is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نَظَرُوا فِيهَا فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ لِحَيِّ وَطَنَا. These awliya, these friends of Allah, these intelligent servants of Allah, when they looked into the dunya, what did they see? He said, نَظَرُوا فِيهَا. They looked into the dunya. فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا. And they realized, أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ لِحَيِّ وَطَنَا. That this dunya cannot be the abode of a person who is living. You're going to say to me, but all of us are alive. All of us are living. What type of living beings are they speaking about? They are speaking about living beings. They are speaking about living beings whose hearts are alive in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are speaking about a people whose hearts are alive in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their bodies live in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرُ كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the example of the one who remembers Allah and the one who doesn't remember Allah is like the living and the dead. Is like the living and the dead. Right? So the person who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person is like someone who's alive. How is it that they are alive? Because that dhikr, that remembrance of Allah that they have, that becomes a light in their lives and that keeps their lives going. Whereas someone who doesn't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their heart becomes darkened, their heart becomes black. And that's the same case of a person who's dead in their grief. Imagine a grave and someone has been just buried and all of this, a ton of earth has been put on top of them. Is there any light down there? No. Will this person be able to see anything? No, it's pitch black. The Prophet ﷺ said, likewise, the one who remembers Allah is like someone who is alive and can walk around in the daylight of the day or in the rays of the moon in the evening. Whereas the one who does not remember Allah is like the dead, have no light at all. So Imam Shafi'i said that when these awliya, radiallahu anhum, they looked into the dunya, they realized that this world is not the place for a living person to live. What type of living person? A person whose heart is alive in the remembrance of Allah. A person whose tongue is moist in the remembrance of Allah. A person whose entire life is in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I visited one of my teachers yesterday, and he said to me, concerning one of his teachers, one of the great awliya of Allah, he said, this particular teacher of mine, he would often say, Ya Rab, when will Qiyamah come? He would often say, Ya Rab, when will Qiyamah come? When will the Day of Judgment come? Right? And my teacher, he had tears in his eyes. He had tears in his eyes when he narrated the story to me. He said, my teacher would say, when will Qiyamah come? And then my teacher said, I said to this great wali of Allah, I said to this teacher of mine, I said to him, Sayyidi, only if you sleep at night a little, because he used to stay awake all night praying. He said, I said to him, Sayyidi, if you sleep a little at night, he said, my teacher said, smiled at me and said, I'll give you an example. He said, people in this world, when they love someone, they don't love someone out in the open. They don't show their love out in the open. They hide away and love. They hide away and love. So when someone has a date, they have a date at night in a restaurant where no one will see them. Their relatives and friends won't know about it. He said, the Shaykh said to me, I'll give you an example of people of the world, people of the dunya whose hearts are filled with the dunya. When they have a date, they go and meet someone at night and they wait and wait. And the time of the date passes and expires. And this person waits and says, perhaps she got late, perhaps she missed a taxi, perhaps there was traffic, and he waits for another day. Why? In anticipation of the beloved. The Shaykh smiled and he said, that's the matter of the people of the world. He said, what do you think of the people of Allah whose hearts are immersed in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How they live in this world? They live in this world awaiting for the Day of Judgment to arrive so that they can have a reunion with their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. They can re-meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاء. Those who love to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet them. وَمَنْ أَبْغَضَ لِقَاءَ اللَّهِ أَبْغَضَ اللَّهُ لِقَاءَ. And those who dislike to meet Allah, Allah dislikes to meet them. So we have to become people who want to meet Allah, who love to meet Allah, who anticipate to meet Allah, who wish to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not people whose hearts are accumulated with the dunya and filled with the dunya. Because when they die, it all be gone. But people whose hearts are immersed in the remembrance of Allah and their hearts are alive, when they reach their graves, that zikr and remembrance of Allah will illuminate their dark graves and bring light to it. So Imam Shafi'i said that these awliya and friends of Allah, when they looked into the dunya, they realized that this dunya is not a place for someone who is alive to live in. So how do they treat this world? He said, جَعَلُوهَا حُجَّةً وَاتَّخَذُوا صَالِحَ الْأَعْمَالِ فِيهَا سُفُنًا. They deemed this world to be an ocean. Lujja. They deemed this world to be an ocean. So, if you need to cross the ocean, how are you going to cross it? With a ferry, with a ship, with a boat, with something or the other, right? With a plank of wood. Don't try it. Sahaba used to try to be a lover. They used to get over the waters. They used to go into the water and say, Bismillah, get to the other end. They knew because this water is only a means. It's Allah who takes us across. So he said that these awliya, they take the world, the entire world, to be a massive ocean. So what's the vehicle that they travel on? وَاتَّخَذُوا صَالِحَ الْأَعْمَالِ فِيهَا سُفُنًا. They take their good deeds as their ships that will take them across this ocean. And when you go get to the other end of the ocean, where do you reach? You reach home. And what's home? The gardens of paradise. So if we want to get over this ocean, i.e. this world that's the ocean, what do we need to do? We need to do good deeds. We need to do salih al-a'mal, righteous deeds. And those deeds will carry us across this ocean. And Imam Shafi'i was very intelligent. He described the world to be an ocean. Why? Because you know the waters of the ocean, sometimes they're steady, but at other times, they are gushing They are going at hundreds of miles per hour, right? And if you have a boat that's weak and it's not strong, what's going to happen when a wave comes? It's going to take you. So that's why he said that we need to have good, healthy, strong, good deeds, that when the waves of this dunya reach us, they can't do anything to us because we're so strong and powerful. And what are the waves of this dunya? What are the waves of this dunya? Fitan, tribulations, trials, right? Being put in the midst of haram, being in a society where everyone is doing haram, right? What's going to stop you from doing what they're doing and keep you strong and traveling towards them? Your righteous deeds will take you across. Then Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, he said, فَإِذَا كَانَ حَالُهَا مَا وَصَفْتُهُ. He said, if this is the state of the dunya, if this is the state of the dunya, وَحَالُنَا, and our state, وَمَا خُلِقْنَا لَهُ, if this is the state of the dunya that which I have described to you, and I've described to you our state, which should be a state of ibadah, فَحَقٌ عَلَى الْمُكَلَّفِ أَنْ يَذْهَبَ بِنَفْسِهِ مَذْهَبَ الْأَخْيَارِ. He said, if what I have described to you of the state of the dunya, and if what I have described to you of our state is clear to you, then the only thing sensible for any human being to do is to take the path of the righteous and the good people. Take the path of the righteous and the good people. وَيَسْلُكَ مَسْلَكَ أُولِي النُّهَى وَالْأَبْصَارِ, and take the path of people of intelligence and people of inner sight. وَيَتَأَهَّبَ لِمَا أَشَرْتُ إِلَيْهِ, and that people should prepare for what I have indicated to them. وَيَهْتَمَّ لِمَا نَبَّهْتُ عَلَيْهِ, and people should concern themselves towards that which I have indicated to them. وَأَصْوَبُ طَرِيقٍ لَهُ فِي ذَلِكَ, and he said the best way in that, وَأَرْشَدُ مَا يَسْلُكُهُ مِنَ الْمَسَالِكِ, the best direction and the best path that can ever be taken is التَعَدُّبَ بِمَا صَحَّ عَنْ نَبِيِّنَا سَيِّدِ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخِرِينَ وَأَكْرَمِ السَّابِقِينَ وَاللَّاحِقِينَ صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَامُهُ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَى سَائِرِ النَّبِيِّينَ. He said the best path that can ever be taken is the path of having adab, the path of having adab with that which we narrate from our Prophet, the master of those who have gone and those who are to come, the noblest of those who have gone and those who are to come. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him and upon all of the prophets. So what is the Imam saying? He is saying that if you know you as a human being will die one day and this dunya will leave you one day, then the best path to take is the path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he used the word التَأَدُّبَ بِمَا صَحَّ عَنْ نَبِيِّنَا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. التَأَدُّب is to bring upon ourselves the adab of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Bring upon ourselves the way and the etiquette and the mannerism and the sunnahs of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم upon ourselves. He said this is the best way in life. وَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, and then the Imam رضي الله عنه, he moves over to another portion of the khutbah. This up till now, the khutbah that he was delivering was explaining to us the state of the world and our state. Now he goes on to something else, but it is related. And what is it that he goes on to? He starts by citing a verse from Surah Al-Ma'idah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Allah said, and help each other upon righteous and good deeds. Help each other upon righteous and good deeds. And then the next portion of the verse is, ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان and do not help each other upon sin and transgression. Help each other upon goodness and righteousness, but don't help each other upon sin and transgression. Why did Imam al-Nawawi mention this verse here? Help each other upon goodness and righteousness. Imam al-Nawawi mentioned this verse here to indicate to all of us that I am going to help you. I am going to help you. I, Imam al-Nawawi, he said, it is as if he is saying, I am going to help you follow that path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by compiling for you ahadith and sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that if you follow them, then you will be following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you follow them, then you will be following the best of paths and the best of ways. And then he said, وَصَحَّ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ It is authentically narrated from the Messenger of Allah صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ that he said, وَاللَّهُ فِي عَوْنِ الْعَبْدِ مَا دَامَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ مَا كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allah is in the help and assistance of a servant so long as that servant is serving someone else. What does that mean? If you serve a brother of yours, if you serve another human being, so long as you are serving them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be in your assistance and help. Allah will be helping you and assisting you so long as you help others. This is what Imam al-Nawawi is trying to say. I am helping you, and so long as I will help you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help me. And then he said, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said, مَنْ دَعَى إِلَى هُدًى كَانَ لَهُ مِنَ الْأَجْرِ مِثْلُ أُجُورِ مَنْ تَبِعَى لَا يَنْقُصُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أُجُورِهِمْ شَيْئًا That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the one who calls towards guidance, the one who calls towards guidance, he will have the same reward as those who follow him. Right? So if you inform someone of a good deed, and that person practices that good deed, you will have the reward of telling them and the reward of them practicing that good deed. Is that clear? Yeah? When you tell someone a good deed, you will have the reward of telling them, number one, calling them towards that good deed, and number two, you will have the reward of them practicing that good deed. لَا يَنْقُصُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أُجُورِهِمْ شَيْئًا And the reward that you will have, i.e. the person who informs the other, this will not decrease from the reward of those who practice that. So you have two people. One person, he informs another of a righteous deed. And the other goes and practices that righteous deed. The person who initially informed that person will have two rewards. The reward of informing that person, number one, and the reward of that person practicing that good deed, number two. But that reward will not be a portion that will be taken from the one who practiced it. No, that will be an additional reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant that person. وَأَنَّهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ لِعَلِيٍّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ فوالله لن يهدي الله بك رجلا واحدا خير لك من حمر النعم. And Imam al-Nawawi رضي الله عنه said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to his cousin سيدنا علي رضي الله عنه By Allah, for Allah to guide one person to you is better for you than the best of the Arabian wealths. And what was the best of the Arabian wealth? Red camels. Red camels were the best of the Arabian wealths. The Prophet said, if one person comes towards guidance because of you, then that's better than everything and the best of the wealths that you can accumulate. So here, by these ahadith, Imam al-Nawawi is encouraging himself and encouraging all of us to call others towards goodness, righteousness, guidance, and knowledge. So Imam al-Nawawi says, فَرَأَيْتُ أَنْ أَجْمَعَ مُخْتَصَرًا مِنَ الْأَحَادِيثِ الصَّحِيحَةِ He said, after I read these ahadith that I have mentioned, I thought to myself, I should gather and compile a short work in which I compile authentic narrations of hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. مُشْتَمِلًا عَلَى مَا يَكُونُ طَرِيقًا لِصَاحِبِهِ إِلَى الآخرة. Such ahadith that encompass ways, etiquettes, mannerisms that if they are practiced, they will become a pathway for the one who practices them to the hereafter, to the akhirah. وَمُحَسِّنًا لِآدَابِهِ الْبَاطِنَةِ وَالظَّاهِرَةِ. And by practicing these ahadith, a person will be able to acquire inner and outer etiquettes and adab. جَامِعًا لِلْتَرْغِيبِ وَالتَّرْهِيبِ. And I want to encompass in these ahadith which speak about matters that encourage a person towards the akhirah, and ahadith that scare a person of the matters of the akhirah. Because you have certain people who, if you encourage them, they will do righteous deeds. But you have certain people, you can speak to them about the gardens of paradise all day long. It won't strike them. You speak to them about the punishments of the fire of hell, and their hearts will shiver. So you have two types of people. وَسَارِكِ أَنْوَاعِ آدَابِ السَّارِكِينَ. And Imam al-Nawawi said, I wish to mention in these ahadith, or in the types of ahadith that I compiled, all of the adab of the awliya, all of the etiquettes and the mannerisms and the behaviors and the pathways of the salikin, the people who tread the path to the akhirah. Min ahadith al-zuhd, from ahadith speaking about abstinence from the dunya. ورياضات النفوس, ahadith speaking about how to train the ego and the nafs. وتهذيب الأخلاق, ahadith speaking about how to refine our character and make it better. وطهارات القلوب وعلاجها, and how to purify the heart and cure it from its illnesses. وصيانة الجوارح وإزالة اعوجاجها, and how we can keep our limbs safe, how we can keep our limbs safe from sins and straighten the crookedness of our limbs. وغير ذلك من مقاصد العارفين, and others from the intent of the Gnostics and the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, here we'd like to mention an important point that Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu said, the types of ahadith I want to mention are ahadith that the awliya, what does this indicate to us? That true awliya, true friends of Allah, are those who adhere to the adab, the etiquettes, the mannerisms, the ways, the characteristics, and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam internally and outwardly throughout their lives. Is that clear? Like the scholars, they mention a story of a student. He heard of a great wali of Allah, a great friend of Allah's. So he thought to himself, let me go and visit him. I might see some miracles. He might bring out some chicken from his sleeves, or hack some eggs and there'll be some gold or silver in it. This is what people think. People think this is wilaya. People think this is a friendship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He might be walking on the waters, but the fish, they swim inside the waters. That's even more miraculous. You know, fly in the air. The birds fly in the air. So this one student, he heard of this great wali of Allah. So he went to his madrasa. He went to his zawiya. He went to his lodge. And he stayed there for a few days. He met the sheikh and he stayed there. After a number of days, he picked up his bags and he was about to head out. And the sheikh saw him and said, oh, so and so, you came, you met us, but you didn't mention why you came. You didn't let us know who you are, and you didn't speak about yourself in any way. And the student said, oh, it doesn't matter. I came to see some miracles. I heard you were a great wali of Allah. I didn't see nothing. I'm off. Right? And the sheikh said to him, hang on. The sheikh said to him, hang on, come, tell me, did you see in the past days that you lived with us and amongst us, did you see any sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being missed out? Did you see any of the etiquettes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not being adhered to? And then the student, he began to think. And he pondered upon the day and the night that he lived with the Shaykh or in his madrasa. And he came to the conclusion and he said to the Shaykh, I did not see a single sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being violated. I did not see a single adab of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being violated. They were all adhered to. The Shaykh said to him, this is the greatest karama and this is the greatest miracle. Adherence to the sunnah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyone who calls you to other than the sunnah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our teachers used to say, فَطْرِبُوا بِهِ عَرْضَ الْحَائِطِ. Our teachers used to say, slam that across the wall. Because that is not from the way of Islam. Imam al-Junayd radiallahu anhu, one of the greatest awliya, he used to say, مَا أَخَذْنَا هَذَا الْأَمْرَ عَنِ الْقِيلِ وَالْقَالِ أَخَذْنَاهُ عَنِ الْجِدِّ وَالْإِجْتِهَادِ. He used to say, this matter of our religion, we didn't take it by talking and telling stories and he said and I said and we said. No, we took it by al-jidd, seriousness, wal-ijtihad, and hard work constantly. And Imam al-Junayd radiallahu anhu, he said, if anyone comes to you and he speaks about wilaya and friendship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he does not memorize the Quran, and he does not speak about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَلَيْسَ مِنْ أَمْرِنَا. He is not from amongst us. Imam Junayd radiallahu anhu said, مَنْ لَمْ يَحْفَظِ الْكِتَابَ وَيَكْتُبِ السُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا. The one who does not memorize the Quran, and the one who does not write a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is not from amongst us. This is the criterion of wilaya. This is the criterion of friendship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The criterion of friendship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not that which is being sold on our streets. It's not that which is being sold on our streets. It's that which was distributed from the member of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's that which came from the blessed mouth of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And look at Imam al-Nawawi. No one from amongst this ummah, no sect, no group of this entire ummah ever raised their finger towards Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu. The entire ummah was always agreed upon the high-ranking scholarship and the high-ranking wilaya that Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu had. And what did he describe to us? He said, I will describe to you in this book how to become a wali of Allah, how to become a friend of Allah. I will describe to you in this book how to become a friend of Allah. But he said, I'm not going to describe that to you from my words. I'm going to describe that to you from the greatest wali of Allah, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is that clear? I'm not going to describe that to you from my words. I'm going to describe that to you from the greatest wali of Allah, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu said, وَأَلْتَزِمُ فِيهِ أَنْ لَا أَذْكُرَ إِلَّا حَدِيثًا صَحِيحًا مِنَ الْوَاضِحَاتِ مُضَافًا إِلَى الْكُتُبِ الصَّحِيحَةِ الْمَشْهُورَاتِ وَأُصَدِّرُ الْأَبْوَابَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ الْعَزِيزِ وَالْآيَاتِ الْكَرِيمَاتِ وَأُوَشِّرُ مَا يَحْتَاجُ إِلَى ضَبْطٍ أَوْ شَرْحِ مَعْنَى خَفِيٍّ بِنَفَائِسَ مِنَ التَّنْبِيهَاتِ وَإِذَا قُلْتُ فِي آخِرِ حَدِيثٍ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ مَعْنَاهُ رَوَاهُ الْبُخَارِيُّ وَمُسْلِمٌ. Then Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, at the end of his khutbah, mentions a note as to the style in which he would compile these ahadith. He said, the ahadith and sayings of the Prophet ﷺ that I will compile in this book will be from the highest levels of authenticity. The highest levels of authenticity. They're not going to be fabricated hadith that people made up. No, the highest levels of authenticity. And he said, I will also mention in the chapters verses from the Quran al-Kareem. And he said, I will also indicate to you meanings of words which are difficult within the chapters that I compile. And then he said, if I say at the end of a hadith, muttafaqun alayhi. If I say at the end of a hadith, muttafaqun alayhi. He said, that means that this hadith was narrated by both Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim radiallahu anhuma. Is that clear? And then at the end of the book, at the end of his khutbah, he says, "Wa arju," and I hope. Wa arju, I hope. إن تم هذا الكتاب, I hope that if I am able to complete this book, I write in this book, أن يكون سائقا للمعتني به إلى الخيرات. I hope that if I can complete this book, then this book will become a guide for the one who takes concern with it, the one who uses it, the one who reads it, the one who concerns himself with this book, that this book will take him to الخيرات, to many goodnesses. حاجزا له عن أنواح القبائح والمهلكات. The first thing that this book will do, he said, inshallah, is drag a person towards goodness and become a veil between that person and قبائح, ugly things, and مهلكات, and things that will destroy a person, i.e. sins and disobediences. And then he has a request. Then he has a request in all humbleness, radiallahu anhu, his great high rank. He says, وَأَنَا سَائِلٌ أَخًا إِنْتَفَعَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْهُ. He said at the end, I ask any brother or sister who benefits from this book, أَنْ يَدُوا لِي, that he prays for me. وَلِوَالِدَيَّ, and prays for my parents. ومشايخي, and praise for my teachers. وسائر أحبابنا, and praise for all of my friends. والمسلمين أجمعين, and praise for all of the Muslims. How beautiful of the Imam, right? And inshallah, we will make dua for Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu. Imam al-Zahabi, one of the great Imams of this Ummah, who wrote encyclopedic works. You know, I bought one of his encyclopedias, known as Sir A'lam al-Nubala, in 28 volumes. I thought this was it. I went to the library on Persia Road and I saw he had another encyclopedia of 40 volumes. And then he had another encyclopedia and he had another encyclopedia. All that he authored himself. Genius scholars of Islam. Imam al-Zahabi radiallahu anhu writes in the biography of one of the scholars of Islam and he says, قَبِيحٌ بِكُمْ أَن تَأْخُذُوا هَذَا الْعِلْمَ عَنَّا وَلَا تَتَرَحَّمُوا عَلَيْنَا. He said, how indecent is it for a student to take this knowledge from us and not to say, Allah have mercy upon my teacher. He said, this is indecent. That the student, the least that the student can do for his teacher is make dua for him. He said, if the student doesn't even do that, then that's extremely indecent. And then Imam al-Nawawi said, وَعَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ اِعْتِمَادِي, and upon Allah the generous is my reliance. وَإِلَيْهِ تَفْوِيضِي وَاسْتِنَادِي, and to him is my dependence and my reliance. وَحَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ, and upon and Allah is enough and he is the best of wakils. And what's a wakil? A person who takes charge of another person's matters. When you say that I make you wakil on my behalf, if you say to someone, I make you wakil on my behalf, go and buy me a chocolate, go and buy me a car, go and buy me a house, I make you my wakil, that means you have given them charge of your affairs. Imam al-Nawawi mentions this dua of the Quran, حَسْبِي اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ, Allah is enough for me and he is the best of those who take charge of anyone's matters. And this dua is mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem concerning the believing people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذَا and when people say to them, إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا. When the believing people say to them, everyone in the world has gathered their armies against you, they don't become scared and tremble and fear. Allah said, فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا, that increases them in iman. Why? وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Why? Because they say, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ, Allah is enough for us. وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ, and he is the best of those who takes charge and who takes matters of others into his hands. جَلَّ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ. And there is no change and there is no power save with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most honorable and the most wise. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله كنز من كنوز الجنة. This statement, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله, is a treasure from the treasures of the gardens of paradise. Right? And لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله is a medicine. It's a cure for what illness? The illness of depression. Someone who is depressed, someone who is down, someone who feels hopeless, aimless, what should they say? They should constantly say لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله, which means what? You know what? I can't do anything anyway. It's all in Allah's hands. So when we give up on ourselves and give in to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's when the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will flow upon us. And by that, we have completed the khutbah of the great Imam Abu Zakariya Yahya bin Sharaf al-Din al-Nawawi radiyallahu anhu. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he allows us to realize the state of the dunya that Imam al-Nawawi has described to us. And he allows us to realize our state that Imam al-Nawawi radiyallahu anhu has described to us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after allowing us to realize all of that, that he makes us from the most intelligent and the most awakened of people, such that we become abstinent from the dunya, such that we become people of the akhirah, people who do good deeds and who want to reach their end destination, who want to return back to their home, which is the garden of paradise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he allows us to adhere to the sunnahs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He allows us to follow the sunnahs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He allows us to pray our five daily prayers on time, ya Rabbil Alameen. He allows our tongues to become moist with the recitation of the Quran al-Kareem, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, fill our homes and our hearts with the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, this dunya deceives us. Oh Allah, we ask you that you shower your blessings upon us such that it can no longer deceive us and we can become more intelligent than to be deceived by this dunya, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, make this dunya for us as you made it for the awliya, ocean that they passed over with their good deeds, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, allow us to understand the truth and see the truth and apply the truth and know the truth and become people of the truth, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, we pray to you as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed, and he said, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'a. Oh Allah, show us the truth as it is the truth and allow us to follow it, ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinaba, and show us falsehood as it is falsehood and not for us to be deceived by it and think it and think that it is the truth, and allow us to keep away from it, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, make us people who are obedient to their parents and to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Make us a people who are obedient to their teachers, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, we pray to you at the end of this blessed khutbah for the great Imam Abu Zakariya Yahya bin Sharaf al-Din al-Nawawi radiyallahu anhu, ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, have mercy upon him, ya Rabbil Alameen. Say Ameen from the depths of your hearts, for if you pray for an Imam like this, my teachers used to say, never miss out on saying Rahmatullahi alayhi or radiyallahu anhu after the names of the Sahaba and after the names of the scholars. Why? When you pray for them, my teacher Shaykh Ismail Zabibi, he said, never miss this out. For how do you know on the day of judgment, when you're in need of good deeds and when you're in need of righteous ranks and stations, you might pass by one of the Sahaba and he might recognize you and say, he prayed for me once, I will take him with me. He prayed for me once, I will take him with me. And likewise, these scholars, right? Our teacher Shaykh Ismail said, never miss out on saying Rahmatullahi alayhi or radiyallahu anhu and praying for the scholars. For in their high ranks on the day of judgment, they might see you and recognize you. You know what? You made a dua for me once, I'm going to take you with me to paradise. Because there will be certain people on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to them, go and find anyone you recognize. Go and find anyone you recognize in the fire of hell and take them with you into the gardens of paradise. So when Imam al-Nawawi is asking us to make dua for him, We should sincerely make dua for him so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him and raises his rank. But also we have much in it for ourselves. What do we have in it for ourselves? That by praying for Imam al-Nawawi, maybe Imam al-Nawawi will hold our hands on the day of judgment and take us into the gardens of paradise. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he raises the ranks of this great Imam radiallahu anhu ya rabbal alameen. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives him and ennobles his rank amongst the ranks of the Salihin ya rabbal alameen. Oh Allah, forgive his parents and raise their ranks ya rabbal alameen. Forgive his teachers and raise their ranks ya rabbal alameen. Forgive his friends and raise their ranks ya rabbal alameen. Oh Allah, forgive the entire ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, we ask you for the Muslims of Asham and Burma and Muslims, wherever they are in need in the world, that you give them aid and assistance, ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, we are in the month of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the month of Ramadan is approaching. Oh Allah, we ask you, as we approach the month of Ramadan, oh Allah, we beg you that we are approaching your victory and your help and assistance, ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, we turn to you with our broken hearts, for the people of Asham and for the Muslims of Burma and the Muslims wherever they are in the world, that you gave them aid and assistance, ya Rabbal Alameen. We ask you for the Muslims in this country and in the Western lands, oh Allah, that you make Iman steadfast in our hearts and in the hearts of our children, ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, as we have come into these lands, we ask you that you make us ambassadors for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People see us and they see a reflection of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, don't make us a people who bring disgrace to Islam and to the Prophet of Islam, ya Rabbal Alameen. Make us a people who only bring honor, who only bring dignity, who only bring goodness to the name of Islam, ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, raise the flag of Islam high above all other flags, ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, protect the Harameen al-Sharifain and purify Masjid al-Aqsa, ya Rabbal Alameen. Allow us all to visit Masjid al-Haram and the Mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rabbal Alameen. ربنا هب لنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم بارك لنا فيما بقي من شعبان وبلغنا رمضان وأعنا فيه على الصيام والقيام وغض البصر وتلاوة القرآن. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.